Hi everyone, welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever wanted to move from shame or blame to freedom, then do we have the Book of Forgiving show for you. Today I'll be talking with Reverend Impa Tutu Venford, daughter of Archbishop Desmond Tutu, a Nobel Prize winner and a peace-loving leader in the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa. She's the co-author, along with her father, of one of the single most important books I have ever read, The Book of Forgiving. And that's just what I want to talk with her about today, about the fourfold path for healing ourselves and our world. That, plus we'll talk about choosing the next right thing, fine arts and electrical engineering, kitchen table ministry, a laptop romance, and what in the world it means to be a prince in high heels. Gotcha. So welcome to the show, Impa. Are you ready to shine?
Yes. I think.
Well, thank you so morning. Much. Good morning for being here, and a mighty woohoo for having you on the show. Before we dive right into things, I'm wondering if you wouldn't mind sharing with us a little bit of your early years growing up in apartheid in South Africa.
So I actually grew up all over the world, but we moved as a family back to South Africa when I was 3 years old. Mm-hmm. And we lived in a place called Alice, which is in the Eastern Cape, which is a predominantly Xhosa-speaking area of South Africa. And my father taught then at the Federal Theological Seminary, which was a seminary for all of the denominations would send their trainee clergy there, and they trained together. And it was what I called an enclave of sanity in the midst of the insanity of South Africa. And so I remember my two best friends at that time, growing up at that time, were a young man called, he wasn't a young man, he was a kid my age, called Duma Gubule, mm-hmm. Whose father was a Methodist minister, and a little boy called Pip, Philip Ashby, whose father was also an Anglican priest like my father. And we used to just rove all over that campus as a pair of kids who knew nothing about apartheid and the insanity that was just beyond the walls of the campus. And I remember going to Port Elizabeth, which was the nearest city, and we drove with Philip and his family to Port Elizabeth in their car, because I think we didn't have a car at the time, I'm not sure. And we were going to go to the beach. And so they dropped us off at the black beach, mm-hmm. and they went off to the white beach. And it was, you know, sort of the strangeness of that was maybe one of the first times that I was really struck by the craziness of apartheid. This boy who I played with all the time, and who in an ordinary part of the world, we would have, you know, gone to the beach together and spent the day together on the beach and played and made sandcastles and done whatever. So that was kind of the first and jarring experience. As I got older, noticing more and more of the apartheid system, my grandfather was the headmaster of a high school that was across the street from their house, and a very well-respected member of the community. But he was a headmaster in the black community. And mm-hmm. as soon as he left that black community and went into town, the youngest white kid would call him boy and, you know, sort of order him around like like a kid, as though he wasn't a dignified and educated man. And that kind of kept going as I grew older. The assaults on dignity were just the dailiness of it was incredible and was wearing. But you know, sort of at the same time, there was this on the one hand, the dailiness of apartheid, the divisions, the indignities, and so on. And on the other hand, I lived a life that was very oddly integrated. So, I mean, because my father was a priest and because he moved up the ranks, so to speak, but that he was an educator and not only a parish priest. So we had friendships that crossed racial lines. We always, at least in my growing up, we always had friends of every race and people, you know, my dad had colleagues of every race. He had both superiors and subordinates of every race. And so I was, I think, inoculated against the myth of racial superiority. Mm-hmm. And then I also had my mom, who was this very an incredibly smart and very perceptive woman, you know, she kind of was one of those, you know, take nothing lying down, challenge every every assumption. Mm-hmm. Why is always a good question. And so, you know, growing up with her was also an experience of having all of the assumptions about superiority based on physical attributes. So whether it was the superiority based on race or the superiority based on gender. That, you know, my parents lived the challenge. They just, you know, the way they lived was a challenge to the assumptions.
Beautiful. And from what I understand, she practiced a lot of kitchen table ministry.
Absolutely. So my mom, you know, people in our communities and in our various communities as we moved around, because we did move quite a lot in my youth, she would always have friends and people to whom she'd offer advice, who just, you know, they'd come over, sit at the kitchen table, have a cup of tea and kind of spill their woes. So, and she, you know, she would listen. Sometimes she would advise, but I think maybe the most potent gift she had was the ability to listen, and to also trust that the person with whom she was sitting knew their own mind. They just needed to hear themselves think. They needed an opportunity to hear themselves think. And I think that's a real gift that we can give each other. It's a very easy gift to give, is to just allow a person to hear themselves think.
It requires presence.
Absolutely.
So can you tell us how your dad was promoting nonviolence and reconciliation during this time?
I don't think that in the early years he was really articulating a non-violent stance. And I think that promoting reconciliation was just central, you know, it was sort of the blueprint on which he lived. So it wasn't a matter of, you know, sort of standing and proclaiming as much as it was a matter of how do you live your life? Mm-hmm. How do you treat the people you encounter every day, regardless of who it is with whom you're having an interaction? So even with the policeman who is being rude and dismissive, you don't have to turn around and give as good as you got. You can refuse to be treated in an undignified manner while treating that person in a, you know, as one worthy of human dignity and concern.
Beautiful. There's a term that you talk about in your book, inclusiveness, of a connectedness between you and the person, even if they're not treating you well.
Yes, absolutely. And my father has both of my parents actually have a real gift of welcome. Mm-hmm. And so I don't quite know how they do it. But there's a generosity of spirit and a disarming care and concern. And so they welcome you into their space in a way.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing on that. Would you mind telling us about your moment of greatest clarity back in Soweto?
This was post 1976. And so each year on June 16th, which was the beginning of the Soweto uprisings, each year on June 16th, there would be a memorial for the Soweto uprisings each year after 1976. And this was maybe 1979, 1980, something like that. And we had gone to Regina Mundi, which is the Roman Catholic Cathedral in Soweto. And at that time, it was the largest indoor facility in Soweto. And so a lot of our vigils, prayer meetings, and rallies would be held at the church. The government had banned political gatherings, mm-hmm. and so we didn't have political gatherings. We had prayer services, and the politicians would come and speak at the prayer service. Mm-hmm. But and so this was a commemoration of June 16th, and my dad had spoken, and the church was absolutely packed. And as we came out of the church, the police and the military had ringed the church. So as people left, the instruction to the attendees was, you know, don't create any provocation, we're going to leave quietly and we're going to go back to our homes and so on and so forth. And that didn't happen. So I don't know, you know, whether what happened first was somebody threw a stone or somebody or one of the police fired a tear gas canister and chaos descended. And so my dad's car was parked inside the yard, and we had the car keys. So we ran back to the car and got inside. The riot police came in to the yard. They just flooded into the churchyard. And my older sister and I managed to get into the car, and then, you know, a whole group of other people piled into the car after us. And so, you know, it was like one of those things that you see from college type movies of, you know, how many people can you fit into a car? I think we managed to fit like 20 people into a Toyota. And my face was kind of pressed up against the windscreen. My immediately older sister didn't manage to get into the car, and so she had gone around the car to kind of block herself, you know, so that the riot police couldn't reach her, but they could. They had these rawhide whips. They're called shamboks. They're really vicious whips. And so the police were standing behind these riot shields, but they could, you know, sort of whip out with this whip. And my sister and her then boyfriend and the pastor at the church were all kind of cowering behind the car, trying to, you know, sort of block themselves from the policeman's whip, and he was just whipping them. Afterwards, when the police left, because there wasn't anything that they were doing other than, you know, they were whipping people and then they'd move on and find someone else to whip, we all, you know, kind of piled out of the car and were trying to console her. And my initial feeling was one of just absolute rage. I had never had the experience of seeing red. My mother would sometimes say, oh, you know, in describing an experience of being angry, that she said, you know, I just saw red. And I thought that it was a reference to maybe a bullfight or something. Mm-hmm. But it's an actual, I don't know, or at least I experienced it as an actual physical thing. I just saw red. I couldn't, you know, there was like every other color leached out of the environment, and it was just in a red wash. I was so furious. And my sisters said to one another, you know, if I had a hand grenade right now, I would pull the pin and throw it at them. And I was like on my way to agreeing with them. I was, you know, literally I could absolutely. And I thought, you know what difference would it make? Mm-hmm. If I do that, what difference does it make? What does it change? It just, you know, we just continue to up the ante. And there has to be a better way. There has to be something else that we can do that actually changes things.
Woohoo!
And that was, yeah, it was a grace moment, you know, a real grace moment.
Beautiful. So from there, if we go forward in the timeline, you didn't really want to become a priest like your dad, did you?
No. no. And actually I couldn't for the longest time in my denomination. I grew up Anglican but ended up being ordained in the Episcopal Church in the United States. And in the Anglican Church, ordination was not something that was available to women. I, you know, it was never up for consideration anyway, which was wonderful as far as I was concerned. I didn't have to think about it. Mm-hmm. And so I did all sorts of, I took the scenic route.
I love
so
it.
So initially I had planned to study fine arts. And then I ended up studying electrical engineering. And then immediately after college fell into nonprofit work, and worked with a nonprofit briefly called the Get Ahead Foundation that was building schools in rural communities in South Africa. And then with the Desmond Tutu Refugee Scholarship Fund in New York, that was educating young men and women from South Africa and Namibia, preparing them for the inevitable change.
Beautiful. And then you got involved in the church. You've done a lot of work in the church. I wonder, we'll fast forward and then we'll dive into the book a little bit. What is a laptop romance?
Laptop love affair?
Yes. Thank you.
My wife and I lived separately for quite a while. So we met in South Africa. She's Dutch and lives in Amstelveen in Amsterdam, just outside Amsterdam. And we did a lot of this Skype and FaceTime. Mm-hmm. were our friends. And so our love affair was lived out a lot on media, social media, on this
technology is pretty cool, isn't it?
Yes, technology is amazing. I mean, I remember the thrill of having a fax machine years. Mm-hmm. Years ago, and just, you know, sort of how immediate a fax seemed as compared to snail mail. Mm-hmm. But yes, I'm dating myself. Yeah,
I'll date myself too then, so I remember those days.
Like, oh, this is amazing, it's a fax. Yeah.
Go ahead. There's a quote from The Guardian, I believe it's from this year, and it was talking about the challenges of your wedding, and it said, and you said, always choose love. Everything else will fall into place somehow. When in doubt, just do the most loving thing.
Yep. I agree with myself. I do. I agree with myself. It's a really good marker for, okay, what do I need to do now? Mm-hmm. Or how do I react in this situation? Or whatever the question is. What is the most loving thing? I think that, you know, that Paul's statements that perfect love casts out fear. Mm-hmm. And that often doing the most loving thing can be doing the most challenging thing, and the thing that you want least to do, or the thing that feels least comfortable in that instance. And yet when you are able to choose the most loving thing to do, the return on your investment is phenomenal.
Woohoo! And it makes me think too, when you choose that, whatever is your least comfortable thing, the thing that you want to do the least, can actually be your richest, greatest teacher in the long run.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So let's go from there and let's talk about forgiveness. And we'll dive more into your story in a bit because that's a big piece of this. What would you say are the simple truths behind forgiveness or the basis of forgiveness?
So in our book of forgiving, we talk about the book of forgiving as being something like a how-to manual. Prior to that, my father had written No Future Without Forgiveness, which we called the why. Why do you need to forgive? And what we lay out are the consequences in our global community of a refusal to forgive, and the consequences in our personal lives of a refusal to forgive. So just we actually engage in daily practices of forgiveness. We just don't always pay attention to what it is that we're doing. If we live in a household with a family, I can, you know, in order for that to work, mm-hmm. In order for that to be possible, we have small daily instances of forgiveness. Oh my goodness, could you ever just pick up the socks from the floor and put them in the laundry basket? Why do you have to stand in front of the fridge with the bottle of milk? What is wrong with getting a glass? You know, why do you have to spend 7 hours in the shower when there's only one shower and there's 93 of us waiting in line to get clean? You know, it's like, you know, so there's the daily practice of we can hold on to those aggravations, mm-hmm. And be miserable, or we can figure out how to just, you know, how to let them go, how to get over ourselves, how to get over the annoyance so that we can live in a loving, more or less loving family and in a peaceable community. And on the world scene, you can, you know, so that you can almost see, you know, Rwanda, a little over 20 years ago, experienced a horrific genocide and made a national decision to promote forgiveness and reconciliation. Are they all the way there? No. Has everybody figured it out? No. But the national decision was that in order for us to go forward as a nation, as a single entity, we're going to have to figure out how to forgive each other and live together and rebuild our society and our communities. And so when you hear about Rwanda now, mm-hmm. what you're hearing about is a society that on many levels is thriving. And the problems and the concerns that Rwanda is addressing now aren't the problems and concerns of ongoing war, of retribution, or anything like that. They are the concerns of a democracy.
Go ahead, please.
No. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say it's jumping. It's circumventing the whole eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth revenge cycle, which never has a happy ending to it. It just keeps going and going.
It never has an ending. And that's the problem with the revenge cycle is you hit me, I am injured, I hit you back, you are injured, you hit me, I am injured, I hit you back, and it just keeps going on. Or you can choose the other cycle, which is the forgiveness cycle, which says, you hit me, I am hurt. I say to you, this hurts, ouch. And I then make a decision that I am going to figure out how to forgive you. And that gets me out of this noxious revenge cycle. I'm going a different way and into something that is infinitely more creative. My dad drew this picture. We actually have it replicated in the book, and that's kind of the extent of my dad's artistic ability. But I thought that it was an important piece of artwork, mm-hmm. and it may be one of the most important pieces of art to be generated in this past century.
It's so important because we don't forget. I spoke with you briefly about it beforehand, and I think there's no more important topic than forgiveness, both externally with others and internally, which we'll get into with ourselves. And so seeing those cycles is so important. Along those lines, then, what is conditional versus unconditional forgiveness?
Conditional forgiveness is still something of a locked door. So I have two daughters. They're 10 years apart in age. And the younger daughter would get very frustrated with her older sister for whatever reason. And she would say, "You have to say you're sorry. And I won't forgive you until you say you're sorry. And then I'm not going to talk to you until you say you're sorry." So the condition of forgiveness is that you say you're sorry and I will then forgive you. And what then happens is that my younger daughter has situated all of the power back with her older sister, because all her older sister has to say is, "Okay, whatever. No, I'm not going to say I'm sorry, and we're done. So end relationship. You're not going to talk to me, and I'm not going to talk to you." And that kind of depends on who's finer with not having a conversation. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, of course, my younger daughter would relent and say, "Oh, okay, you know, I'll forgive you," because conditional forgiveness isn't a thing. Forgiveness has to be a grace. It is given freely. But the mentality that's attached to conditional forgiveness is that I am doing something for you. And until we recognize that forgiveness is the gift that we give to ourselves. So when I forgive you, actually, yeah, I'm doing something for you, but I'm really doing a whole lot more for myself. I am the one who is truly liberated by being able to forgive you.
That's huge then. So this kind of begets the question, forgiveness is not weakness, it's actually courage or strength then.
Oh, yes. It is indeed the most loving thing, which, of course, being the most loving thing is the simplest, mm-hmm. but not the easiest.
Would you mind sharing? I almost hate to go there because it's just so hard, but I think it's a beautiful lesson in here. What happened in April of 2012?
Wow. In April of 2012, we had moved back. My daughters and I had moved back to Cape Town in July of 2011. We hired a housekeeper whose name was Angela, and Angela very quickly wound herself around our hearts. She was an absolute sweetheart. And in April of 2012, I had called her because my younger daughter was going to be coming home early and she just needed to know that. And I kept phoning the house and there was no answer. And so eventually I went past to go and drop off my daughter, but the gate was open, or there was something about it that didn't look right. So I drove on and I took my daughter to my mother's house and asked my brother-in-law to come with me to my house to check what was wrong. And when we got home, we walked through the house and there was still no sign of Angela. And then we got to my older daughter's room and Angela was on the floor in a pool of blood. She had been strangled and then her throat cut. It was horrific. We had somebody working for us then as a gardener who was later found guilty of the crime. It was just it's such a waste. The police came through and asked us to go, asked me to go through the house and see whether, you know, what was missing. And I remember the policeman asking me, was anything taken? And I thought, yeah, a life. What else matters? What else counts? Not just one life. You really come to recognize how profoundly interconnected we are. I remember phoning her mother and, you know, feeling that I had to tell her mother what had happened because, I had to do it. And just the keening, the anguish, the shriek, and her, she has a son and a daughter, and she, who she loved so much and who she was so proud of. She'd phone them and, you know, tell them what she was doing and how, you know, and ask them about their lives. And yeah, it was such a waste of, and even the young man he's in jail now, but he was such a beautiful young man, and with so much promise. I don't know what happened. I don't, you know, like what happened to him, in his heart.
Thank you so much for sharing. What's really special to hear, and this goes along the lines of your book and what you're teaching, is that you even have the ability to see the humanity and the beauty, at least in where the gardener was before this, mm-hmm. is huge.
Yeah, but it's such a waste. Yeah.
So I guess we'll bring it back up from there. The importance of telling the story, because that's what you're doing, and that's part of this process.
Mm-hmm. You have to tell the story. And often telling the story is the hardest part of the process. It's the hardest part of the process because sometimes there is shame attached to the story, or there is such deep pain attached to the story, or there are pieces of ambivalence attached to the story. But you need to be able to tell the story in order to be able to really see it. What we often do is, you know, sort of edge in and then run away, you know, edge in and then run away again from it. So it's like, you know, like it's like having a cut and you kind of you tap the cut, but you never clean it. Mm-hmm. You never clean it out and allow it to heal. You're just always kind of nagging at it, worrying away at it. And that's what happens when you don't tell the story and you don't sort of get it out to your satisfaction.
It makes me think of heart disease, which they now say the leading cause of heart disease is a broken heart. And mm-hmm. part of that may not be having forgiven others or forgiven ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. You can't identify or name the hurt without telling the story. And so it's as you tell the story that you're able to identify, okay, this is where it hurts. Mm-hmm. This is what of this story is so painful to me.
So in naming the hurt, what's the role of grief and anger in this?
Naming the hurts and even that whole forgiveness process is one that you might find yourself needing to, I thought I was done telling the story, but wait, there's something else mm-hmm. that I needed to assert or, acknowledge. In naming the hurt, there is a real grief because there's a real sense of when we're injured, an injury is the inability of someone else to see me as human, beautiful, and deserving. Mm-hmm. And so it's to be seen and therefore to be treated as less than a child of God. And when I am treated as less than a child of God, that is the hurt, and there is the grief of, you know, that deep pain of not being fully seen.
That makes sense. From there, anger, because sometimes, well, we're taught here, at least in the West, you can't be angry. You must stuff that anger down. Anger is a bad emotion.
There's, you know, the reality is there's no such thing as a bad emotion.
Thank you.
Emotions just are. That, you know, it is. I am angry, it is. What I do about it can be helpful or not. But the feeling is a feeling. And if you are angry, you're fully entitled to your anger. What you do as a result of your anger or what you do with your anger, now that's a whole different issue altogether.
Thank you.
And so it's, you know, it's important. Anger is a flag. It's a way of your being saying there's something wrong here, and it's a a marker. There's something wrong here. I'm not being treated properly, or someone else is not being treated properly. And then what am I going to do about it? So I am angry. Do I retaliate? Do I speak up? Do I act out? You know, how do I respond to the feeling?
Beautiful. Well, the anger is not beautiful, but actually, in a sense, the anger is beautiful.
It's a teacher.
Yes.
Yeah. If you accept your anger as a teacher, and you ask, you know, with any teacher, you get the most out of them by asking them questions. So ask it. Okay, what are you doing here?
From there, let's talk about granting forgiveness. And what does it mean to recognize our shared humanity?
So granting forgiveness is ultimately to say, I no longer reserve the right to retaliate against you. And I'm willing to reconcile, to move into a different form of relationship with you than the relationship that is based on the anger, or that is based on the harm, or where the harm is the central fact of our relationship. Wait, you asked me another question. You had a piggyback question.
Shared humanity.
Shared humanity. Shared humanity just means that that I recognize that I could be on the other side of this equation needing forgiveness as well. You know, we're very keen to believe the best of ourselves and the worst of the people who hurt us. And the reality is that that we're both capable of the worst kinds of depravity and the best kinds of empathy and kindness.
Thank you. I think that's really important for people to hear. From there, you have a beautiful, beautiful line in the book. It says, I forgive so that it is not the main plot of our life story, and so that we can go on to write new stories, better stories, happier stories.
Yeah, thank you. That's some good writing.
Don't know where that came from.
Yeah, really. But that's actually very much the experience of writing is, oh, where did that come from? But yes, that our worst moments aren't the full description of who we are or of what our relationship is. The worst moments of our relationship are the worst moments of our relationship. Unfortunately, the best moments of our relationship aren't fully descriptive of our relationship either. Most of the time, we're kind of chugging along idling along on a cruise control, and you know, from time to time we hit the speed bumps, mm-hmm. and from time to time we hit some real blissful highs.
So I guess the challenge is to keep us out of autopilot as much as we can.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
So let's go from there. Let's talk a little bit about forgiving yourself. I do a lot of coaching work with people, and obviously I've had a lot of people on the show, and it seems to me the most important place or way to heal yourself or to free yourself is to begin to forgive yourself.
Yes. for many people, self-forgiveness is the most difficult act of forgiveness to accomplish. We are willing to reach out to others in ways that we're not willing to reach into ourselves. My dad describes this lack of self-forgiveness. He talks about it in himself as you know, it's a piece of arrogance, actually, because he says, you know, I know from my prayer and my practice and my belief. So, you know, there intellectually I have it. God forgives me, but I can't forgive myself. And essentially what I'm saying to God is, you know, you don't know how bad I've been. You really don't get it. Which I know better.
I see the arrogance of that statement. I know better than you, God.
Exactly. And so, you know, when you're able to really to access the arrogance of that statement, is, you know, so how can God forgive me, and how can I access that for myself? You know, you sometimes you need to be able to maybe just take a half step outside yourself and look at yourself with the same compassion that you're able to show to those who you love. And honestly, one of the imperatives of my religious practice, of Christian practice, is loving yourself. Is, you know, I mean, what the Bible says is love your neighbor as you love yourself. So you kind of need to have a high level of love for yourself to be able to love your neighbor in the way that they're worthy.
It's such a powerful statement. We had an interview a couple of days ago with a gentleman, Bruce Feiler. His interview will come out in a few weeks. He talks about the story of Adam and Eve, the biblical story of Adam and Eve. And one of the lines that we were talking about is the true importance of that line you just said, love your neighbor as thyself. And what it really means is to how deeply you get to love yourself.
Absolutely.
How does one, when somebody comes to you and they say, when I try to love myself, I just get angry, what do you tell them?
I don't know whether you've ever prayed through an icon.
Give an example. Maybe I have.
So in many of the Orthodox churches, they have icons. So icons of saints and so on.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Praying with an icon is first praying with your eyes open. And one doesn't pray to an icon. One prays with or through an icon. So the point and purpose of an icon is that an icon shows you through to God. So, you know, through, as you look at the icon, you are able to access something about God. So it's not the point of an icon isn't to be a beautiful work of art. It is actually to be a work of it's almost a scripture of, you know, so the, here is your holy reading. And so often when people have a challenge with loving, accepting themselves, I say in your prayer, in your time of prayer, use a mirror. And the mirror is then your icon. And I invite you to look at yourself and see yourself as God sees you. For God, you are made in the image and likeness of God. In God's eyes, you are this beloved and beautiful child. And so the practice that I invite you into is a practice of seeing yourself with God's eyes. And, you know, what would it be to see yourself as God sees you, as this that I have not just created, but like you're crafted and created. I love the image of in Genesis of God kind of playing in the mud. Mm-hmm. You know, spits in the and makes a little mud ball, and he's, you know, like I'm actually going to form this human being out of mud, of my spit and my breath, and yeah, that there's this real intentionality in how you are crafted and created. Mm-hmm. that you're not made of a happenstance. You're very deliberately formed by God.
Thank you. Along those lines, there's a lot of confusion, though, in or out of church about guilt. How do we start to work through the guilt that we've had or almost inherited, and so we don't feel we're worthy, for instance?
And isn't that what Jesus' death and resurrection was about? It wasn't about saying that we are worthy. It is about saying that through my death and resurrection, I, Jesus, have made you worthy. I have claimed you. I have redeemed you. I have bought you back from that slavery to sin. You're mine now. You don't belong to the evil. You don't belong to the devil. You belong to me, and I claimed you not once but once for all. So, you know, like until the end of time, you're mine.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. How do we, or what does it mean to cultivate forgiveness? And you're talking about, in the beginning, you were talking about cultivating it in the home, at the fridge, with the milk.
Yes. It's just, it is that the practice that we articulate as a fourfold practice. So you tell the story, you name the hurt, you forgive, you reconcile, and so you don't kind of blow past the I can't stand it when he drinks milk out of the bottle at the refrigerator. You say, I can't stand it when you stand at the refrigerator and drink milk out of the bottle. Please, will you get a class? So there you've told the story, you've named the aggravation, and then you've made an opening for reconciliation. That, you know, here's a glass, and that, you know, you've forgiven and moved on. And that's the daily practice is, don't get out of the practice of sweeping things under the rug, mm-hmm. or getting over it without speaking of it, and really claim the right to name what's going on, because as we build that muscle, we are able to live lives of wholeness and integrity.
Is that what it means to develop a mindset of forgiveness?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And I can imagine how much it'll change the world if we bring that with us out into all of our interactions. If we're seeing that other person, truly seeing that other person, and following each of these steps in any of our interactions.
Mm. Yes, that is certainly the hope.
What would you say is the importance of doing one small thing each day to make someone else's life better?
Well, that's just a gift to yourself. Because it doesn't have to be huge, but it's amazing how self-affirming it is to be able to do something for someone else. We all want to be able to do something for someone else. There's a great power in that, and we all want access to that power to do good, and it really doesn't have to be huge. It can be the smallest thing, the compliment, the smile, the cup of coffee. Yeah.
I think that's such a powerful statement that you just made, the word power again. We all want the power to do something good. That's huge.
Yeah, we do.
Woohoo! My wife, Jessica, she's the producer. She always likes me to ask a question just before the end. We'll do a brief wrap-up and a real short meditation. But what would you tell parents today to help their kids to understand forgiveness?
You know, I think that kids have a really deep understanding of forgiveness that we as adults kind of sometimes paper over. Because we as adults will often go to say you're sorry, I'm sorry, you know, forgive him, you're forgiven, and you know, off and you know, sort of go off into the wild blue yonder when you both people walk away with a, you know, both kids kind of walk away with a sense of that didn't sound right or fair or just or anything. It didn't, you know, it didn't feel like either of us got attended to in the way that we needed to be attended to. And so I think as parents, sometimes the offering is to trust our kids to work it out. Just let them go work it out themselves. We don't always have to helicopter in and solve the problem for them. And it can, you know, there can be some hairy moments along the way. But typically, children want to get back to that place where they can play together again. And so they will figure out how to get to a piece of fairness that allows them to go on together.
I love it. It's huge. Learning from our kids about reconciliation.
Oh yeah. I mean, they have our kids tend to be quite clear about their vested interest in reconciliation.
That makes sense. So, question we like to ask all our guests just before the end is, what personally brings you the greatest happiness, or what I call the woohoo factor?
Oh, my goodness. I have so many woohoos. Today, my big woohoo is that it was misty and yuck in the morning, and it's blue sky right now, and it's spring. Super woohoo. I live in a household with people who I love. Absolutely woohoo. I get to live with my wife, which is amazing.
That's a miracle unto itself.
That is indeed a miracle unto itself. My parents are still alive and kicking, more or less. How woohoo is that? Mm-hmm. I am so deeply privileged. At 15, I
that was great.
Can I
quote you on that?
I feel as though I'm really looking forward to the next chapter of my life.
Woohoo. And you are exuding gratitude when you say that.
Ah, thank you.
So, any last words of wisdom you want to share with people before we do a brief meditation?
No. The power of gratitude is immense. I have a cup that says comparison is the thief of joy. Mm-hmm. And that very often we look at what we have or what we have to do, and we compare it with what other people have and what they have to do. And we always kind of, sort of rank ourselves down, and then are annoyed by what we don't have, and by how much we have to do. And sometimes it's just enough to be thankful for having enough.
I love it. As somebody, I've had a couple near-death experiences. I've been extremely fortunate to still be here and to be able to lay on the couch broken and to simply be able to lay on the couch broken huge. Absolutely huge.
Wow. Yeah.
Thank you so much. This has been so, so amazing, an honor, a privilege. Would you have a brief meditation you wouldn't mind sharing with us?
this meditation is to invite you to create a safe space for yourself. And it's a safe space that you can access whenever you need to retreat. And it's a safe space that you can access even if you have to retreat in the midst of hustle, bustle, and other people. And so I invite you, if you would like, to close your eyes.
As long as you're not driving that car.
As long as you're not driving the car. But at the moment, you're just constructing a space for yourself. And so we begin. Just give yourself a couple of deep breaths just to cleanse and center. And now I'd like you to see yourself in an environment in which you love to be. You can choose whether you are inside or outside. You feel the sunshine, the warmth of the air. Feel yourself seated in a comfortable place. Maybe leaning against a firm but soft surface and resting with the softness of earth or fabric beneath you. Know that in this place you are safe. It is a place in which you can invite others, but they can only come at your invitation. Notice the fragrance of the air around you. The softness. And you hear around you softness of breeze, maybe distant music. But again, it is your space, your sanctuary, your safe place. And in this place, you can breathe and be. You can relax and recharge. Make this as vivid a scene as you can. What colors do you see around you? What scent do you experience? What sounds come to you that make you feel safe and comfortable? And relax. Now you can enjoy your space for a few moments. When you're ready, just take a last look around. Know that you can lock this space away in your heart. And when you're ready, open your eyes. And come back into the room.
Ah. Woohoo! Thank you. I almost forgot to ask, I was so taken away by this. Where can people go to find out more and to find your beautiful book?
The book is available from all the major retailers and online. Please do buy. And there's a forgiveness.com that has bookofforgiveness.com that has more on our work and project.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. We support you, we support you, we support you.
God bless you.
God bless you as well. Got to crank it up for the finish.
Yeehaw!
Woohoo! For everyone out there, this is Michael Sandler saying be well, have fun, get the Book of Forgiving, and set yourself free and shine bright. Woohoo! Thank you, thank you, thank you, Mepa.
Thank you. Bye, Michael.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe, see the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!